Philemon is perhaps one of the least well-known. It's possibly the less well-understood books as well of the New Testament. But there's strong competition for the less well-understood, let's face it. It's written by Paul. He's in jail. There's too much doubt about these bits and pieces. Probably during his first imprisonment in Rome under Nero, dates from around 60 to 62 AD. But it's probably nearer the front end of that time scale because Philemon lives in Colossae, right? Remember the letter of the Colossians? Philemon has got a house church in Colossae. And Colossae is hit by an earthquake sort of partway through AD 60. And it's flattened. And it's really not properly rebuilt then again. It's like a little, you know, it's really devastated by this earthquake. So it's a miracle we've got a bit of it at all. It's a miracle we've got Philemon handed down to us because it's written to this place that's about to be flattened. Yeah? This church of Colossae that we know had problems and heresies going on. Okay, that picture then is a portion of this papyrus 87. That particular one dates from the late 2nd century AD. So again, we're quite close in time. In reality, you know, it's a piece of it, we've got it in our hands. So where are we then? The Lycus River Valley. Laodicea is one of the churches in this valley. The whole string of these are a number of these are mentioned in Revelation chapters 2 and 3. Okay, but Colossae is at the head of the valley. Now I don't know if you've travelled up the Bran Valley towards Llanwrtyd Wells. Have you been up that way yet? Right. Well, you go up there. You've got this big hill towards a sort of funny shaped mountain called the Sugarloaf.
Yeah.
And as you go up, you come to a place called Cymhordy. You'll have trouble saying it, because most people do, right? And there's a big, huge viaduct there. The railway goes up that valley and so on. What it is, Philemon, if you like, lives in Colossae. And you can see that the rivers start in this area. And you trace that river around, you go over the mountain pass to Phrygia and Pisidian Antioch, and that's where his wife comes from. So she's a girl from over the top, and she's come down the valley there to marry, by the look of it, marry Philemon. It's a letter then, it's a letter that Paul writes pretty personally. He writes to Philemon, leading Christian in the church at Colossae. Man known to Paul, but Paul never really went to Colossae. What happens is he sits down at the port in Ephesus, about 100 odd miles, 150 miles down that river, and people come down there. And he's got like this centre going on, preaching the gospel in the lecture hall of Tyrannus for 3 years-ish. These people are travelling down. So here's an example for us of how to reach a really rural area. Okay? Up the river. These people come down to the port, they do their business, they go back to their towns. And that's what's going on with guys like Philemon. Wealthy guy, goes down, does his trade, comes back up, and Paul is just there doing all that. Looks like Epaphras is the guy who went up and planted the church in Colossae, and again he's back and forth, he's got the support of sort of mothership. Down in Ephesus. Yeah, does that make sense? That's what's going on in the background here. So what's the book about? This is the introductory bit because we're starting a new series, okay? So sorry about this. What's it about? People have different sorts of ideas. You'll see different theories in different books. Christianity and slavery. That's a big one because it's all about asking Philemon to release Onesimus, the slave who's run away. He's found Paul in Rome. He's been converted to Paul in Rome. Sending him back as a runaway slave, and Paul is saying, please free Onesimus because I want him in my gospel work. That's the scenario. So people say it's about Christianity and slavery. I'm not sure it is. Certainly in the missionaries of the world, they say it's a demonstration of how Christianity challenges culture. Well, that's because that's what they're into, isn't it? And he's saying, you know, you've got this slave situation, how do we deal with that as Christians? When one becomes a brother. Some people say it's just a personal request. Tends to be the sort of intellectuals or theologians who say that's just a personal request. What's it doing in the Bible? I want to open up a window on the early church and the way the early church worked. I reckon pretty much what you've got is Paul is writing to an individual while the church is watching. And he's trying to say something about Christian life and so on. This opens a window for us on what happens when people are converted, how churches manage that and so on and so forth. What we got then is a demonstration of the authentic life of the early church as it gets stuck into world mission and working out the implications of the gospel of grace as it goes along. Here's a window being opened for us on an early church in a rural type setting, yeah? And how you reach those sorts of areas for the Lord. So it's going to be boring for you because it's from St. Okay? Fancy warning. What you've got, how is it done? How do you reach places like this? It's done with apostolic teams. And in Scripture, here's the first emphasis in this church in Colossae. Here's the first emphasis in this letter. The emphasis is on apostolic teams. Okay? People who, together, go into a place to do something pioneering. First emphasis of the Pauline mission is the fundamental role of apostolic teams in taking forward the kingdom of God. A lot of people talk about it, right? Not many people do it. And even in prison, Paul isn't alone. He's got his team with him. Timothy has been his pretty constant companion since Acts 16. Okay? Going off into this Asian mission. Silas has come along for a while. Aquila and Priscilla are along for a while too. No fixed elite, just a bit of a rolling ruck, gaining pioneer missionary experience as part of a team alongside the old guy Paul, who's been doing it a long time. He's had a right old beating and has learned lots of things along the way. Right? Alongside this apostolic band, serial pioneers, moving on, pioneering, you then get people coming alongside that. Because that group is growing ministry within and around the edges of it all the time. And it's like a rolling ruck. So Paul is writing to Philemon, our dear friend and co-worker, Apphiasis, the Archippus of Philadelphia, the church that meets in your home. These are the guys who are sort of settled there, whose ministry has been grown around the edge of this, sorry, it's a rugby analogy, isn't it? Can you manage? A rolling ruck. You know, it's all going on there, but around the edges, people are peeling off and moving on. And apostolic teams, growing ministry, around the edges, moving it on. Ministry has grown around the edges of this apostolic team. Obviously, according to their calling, their growth in grace, the ability they develop to serve the Lord, they're sharing ministry. That's going to be an emphasis that comes up in a minute. First characteristic, the gospel goes forward with apostolic teams there. And then the second characteristic of the way mission's working around the Pauline mission this time is they're in trouble. They're in trouble with the authorities. Paul says he describes himself as prisoner of Christ Jesus. That tells you two things. It tells you, A, they're in trouble, and secondly, it tells you how they view the trouble they're in. Okay? The prisoner of Christ Jesus. The gospel was never far from trouble with the authorities. Why? Because they were seeking first the kingdom of God. And there are times when that cuts across the kingdoms of men. Fair enough? Now the way they handled it was, they didn't compromise their stance for the kingdom of God. They just took what came to them as a result from the kingdoms of men. So Paul's a prisoner of Christ Jesus. Is he ashamed? Is he cowering in a corner? No, he's there with his apostolic team in that prison, and he's about the Lord's business. Elsewhere, you'll find Paul starts his letters. He says, I'm a servant of Jesus Christ, Romans 1. Or, Paul, called to be an apostle, 1 Corinthians 1, where he's got a sort of a service authority with it because the church is going off track. But here, prisoner of Christ Jesus. Who's he a prisoner of? He's a prisoner of Nero. Is he? Because he has got a view of what he's doing, of his God, and the way his God works through what he's doing, that tells him that Nero is not in charge of this situation, you see. Yes, he's in trouble with these authorities, but actually, he's a prisoner of Christ Jesus, because his view of the sovereignty of God is such that he knows he wouldn't be there unless Jesus had put him there. And he's there for the glory of God.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Now, you've got to apply that a bit to some of our circumstances, perhaps. Perhaps we've got things going on in our lives that are not very happy at the moment. We're not very happy with. Don't understand. Why are we here? We're here because somehow the God that we adore and that we serve and to whom we've yielded our lives has got something he's doing in it. We don't get it. It makes no sense for a preacher to be locked up in jail, does it? He's your number one apostle to the Gentiles, you know? And there he is stuck in a jail. What's the meaning of this?
Depends how good he is,
doesn't it? Yeah, he wasn't the church a lot tonight. He was the authorities. Yeah, because he's good. Yeah. That's where you're at with this. Paul rationalizes imprisonment in terms of the sovereignty of God. Paul is God's servant. And if in his all-wise providence God ordains Paul should be locked up in a Roman jail, then Paul is not Nero's prisoner, but Christ's prisoner. And he's going to continue his apostolic mission from where he is. Tiny little bit about frustration in trying to pioneer and preach and all that stuff. tiny amount compared to this guy. But look what he's got on it. We are, of course, being shown that Paul's gospel gets you in trouble with the authorities. Because the authorities are determined to misappropriate God's authority to themselves, to legislate in areas where they have no right to be, and certainly where they have no right to be opposing God's word. But they do it. They did it for him, they'll do it for us. And we're also being shown how to relate to the persecution that arises out of this when it befalls us, because it comes to us with, to some strange extent, with and from the hand of God. I'm a prisoner in Jesus Christ, in a sense. Not some abstract theoretical idea. This church at Colossae sprang out of the church at Ephesus and the work at Ephesus, and we know that the work at Ephesus was troubled with all sorts of things. As soon as Paul was thrown out of the synagogue there, when he was in the lecture hall at Tyrannus, when he was doing that 3-year stint there, we know Demetrius the metal worker kicked up a riot, under pressure all the time. It's not abstract and theoretical. This is what happens. Characteristics of this early church, of this early church planting effort, they used apostolic teams and they were in trouble with the authorities. First things to hit you out of those opening verses of Philemon. It's not just that though. Yeah, fellow soldier. Soldiers get shot at. Simple. It's not just that. There's shared ministry. There's apostolic teams, but there's shared ministry. Great to see David here last week. Well, it wasn't great for me to see David here last week because I was somewhere else last week. Okay, getting ministered to. Brilliant. Shared ministry. We need to do more of that. I think we need other people preaching more. Not only because you get sick of the sound of my voice, which you haven't yet, but you might have done already, but it happens, you know. And also because other people bring other things that they need. And it's good for them. It's good for them too. Shared ministry. Look. Paul talks about it's to Philemon, our co-worker. Ministry's grown around the edges of the apostolic teams. To some extent, of course, while it is grown, ministry gets shared, but certainly after it's grown, ministry is shared. Philemon is not our worker. Philemon is our co-worker. And it's the Apostle Paul speaking. That's ever so important, isn't it? He's not the person treated like the apprentice who starts as an apprentice pushing a broom and graduates to being allowed to make the team. I see that. Where churches are able to have teams of lads training, that's what happens. Happens a lot. I'm going to be a bit personal and embarrass Karis, but it was great on Friday night. Karis would come with me to go and visit an elderly lady who'd been bereaved. Devastatingly so. And it was great to see Karis there pick up and run. Brilliant. I just felt prompted to get out and go in the kitchen and talk to somebody else. It was great to see Karis pick it up, you know? Mm-hmm. How do you do more of that? You could have come. I'd have invited you. I didn't know you were here. But we need to do more of that. As co-workers together. Because the only way you or I or any of us go into situations of difficulty and deal with people and help them is in dependence on the same God that they're dependent on anyway.
Yeah.
Hopefully we've got good at listening. But you won't always work for them either. Our co-worker. Our worker together. Philemon is Paul's co-worker, not his skivvy. And then there's Aphia, our sister. This woman with a name from over the top of the mountain pass and down the other side in Phrygia. She's a bit odd, she is. She's from over there. But no, we're all together in this multi-ethnic, diverse community of people. We can cope with eccentricity and difference, hope so. Because that's what a church is supposed to do. Said a bit already about this guy, Archippus, our fellow soldier. Paul doesn't refer to Christians as soldiers. He refers to people who have been in a tussle with him as soldiers. People who, for the sake of the gospel, are fellow soldiers with him because they've taken some incoming fire for the stance for the gospel. Our fellow soldier. Not we were out front leading and looking after the people who are also taking a bit of flak behind us. We all have a right to suffer for our faith, our brothers and sisters, and our children. That is hard to watch, isn't it? Archippus, our fellow soldier. So these things characterise that early church mission then. Apostolic teams, in trouble with the authorities, prisoner of Christ Jesus, shared ministry, Philemon, our co-worker, and so on and so on. And look at this scary bit. The church met in homes. Now this is scary and relevant to us, isn't it? We do live in a society here, we live in a culture here, you may obviously to some extent in Cardiff as well, where church means pointy church. Church means building and structure. And outside of that, you're a bit unusual. This is a church that clearly meets in Philemon's home. House churches are often mentioned in the New Testament letters, but they're underemphasized in our time. Sometimes you might find the whole body of Christians in a city meets in a home because it's a small church. Sometimes you find the church in the city is much bigger than any one house can accommodate, like Rome, you know, they've got them all over the place. And part of the church meets in a home. So we were saying, it looks as if Epaphras was the planter in Colossae, we get that from Colossians 4:7-ish. But the house church was hosted by Philemon. Possibly a wealthy guy whose house could hold quite a few people, but not necessarily. Paul writes then to Philemon, the leaders whose names he's mentioned, and consciously to the whole church gathering in their homes, the church that meets in your home. Now it's noteworthy that until about the middle of the 3rd century AD, Christians didn't own buildings for worship. Where's that come from? It's a really, you know, it's a later idea. So, the church in Colossae met in Philemon's house. In Laodicea, the church, Colossians 4:15 says, the church met in Nympha's house. And then we read in Philippi, the believers that Paul found down by the river on the Sabbath, who were trying to hold a Jewish place of prayer down by the river, they were found after their conversion where? Acts 16:15, meeting in Lydia's house. Another example comes from Corinth, the church that meets in Gaius's house. Romans 16:23, Gaius, who is host to me and to the whole church, greets you. Smaller church groups appear to have met in the church in Corinth, 1 Corinthians 14:23, in homes. And Priscilla and Aquila, moving around, renting a place. They were all over the place, but certainly in Corinth they had a rented home. We'll use that then. Rome, they rented out, we'll use that then. And the church in Corinth and Rome used their home to meet in. We know very little about this. We know very little about how these home groups worked. But we do know this is what was done. And the practice is elaborated from the start of the era of the church, because in Acts 2, where do they meet? Okay, I'm talking too much. So, where do they meet in Acts 2?
Demetrius.
You
see the guy that fell down?
No, it's the metal worker in Ephesus who's trying to beat the church up. Great idea, but not that one. Acts chapter 2. Okay, Paul, did David do this last week? Brothers, what do we need to do to be saved, says Peter in his Pentecost sermon. Yeah, and then it's, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of the Lord Jesus, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you'll receive the Holy Spirit. Right, fine, fantastic, that goes ahead. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to the prayers. And then you go down to verse 46, and it says, they met together daily in the temple courts, but they broke bread in their homes. They're evangelizing the remaining Jews in the temple courts, under Solomon's colonnade, where you could talk and get people to listen and stand around and stuff, back and forth. But they broke bread in their homes. It's from the earliest days of practice, and then you see it working out. Not because they were small, because that first day of Pentecost there were 3,000 converted, weren't there? And then a chapter a bit later on, there's 5,000 converted. You think, where are we going to put all these? We need a big hall. Hang on. Here's how we do it. There's a place, public outreach, in the temple courts. Later in the Pauline mission, it could be in various synagogues around the place. In the marketplaces in the Greek world. On one occasion, a hired hall, the lecture hall of Tyrannus. Private teaching, fellowship, agape meal, breaking of bread in their homes, must have been multiple homes. Public ministry in various, wherever there were people. Interesting. Here's the characteristic of that early church, characteristic of the Pauline mission, apostolic teams, in trouble with the authorities, shared ministry, church meets in homes. But then comes the big thing. Because those are the methodological issues, aren't they? Here's how we set about it. But here's what makes us tick. Paul Paul says, grace to you, verse 3, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. They're focused on grace. They're focused on grace. What does that mean? Well, obviously Paul has taken a standard greeting for letters and he modifies it and puts good Christian theology in it. He's been expressing a deep prayerful concern for Philemon, Naphia, for Archippus, the church that meets in their house. How's he going to do that? He says he wants God's grace to be big with them. He wants God's grace to be big with them. Don't know what it's like where you are, because you're in a really, I'm conscious, you're in a really different culture, you know? Up here, chapel is expected to be full of people who wag your finger at you and tell you you should have come sooner. You know? You turn up, they're nasty to you, because you haven't been. You phone your granny and you're trying to be nice to the old girl, you know, and she wags her finger and she says, you shouldn't go to chapel! What an incentive. How marvellous. Oh, thank you so much, grandmother. I shall be there next week. What time is it? It's not going to happen like that, is it? That's what's expected. But actually, we're supposed to be about the opposite of all that. We're supposed to be about grace. Well, how's that going to affect the way we tackle people? Accepting of people? Not their sin, people. Kind, welcoming. Certainly not on your high horse, because the whole point about grace is I'm a sinner and I've got no hope unless Jesus saves me. How did that come through in the way I deal with people? Grace to you and peace from our Father, God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Here's what we need to be big about. Now that's the right order, of course. Grace, then peace, isn't it? Grace comes first. You can't know the peace without first knowing the grace. But peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ comes right along behind it, right with grace. If grace is big in us, peace is going to be big in us. There's a nasty, nasty little thought for a Sunday morning. If grace is big with us, peace is going to be big with us. It's important. How's that going? We live in a world that's sort of devoid of these things. It's full of justifying yourself. No, you don't meet the standard of some sort, but grace is poor. It's full of a world where people are sort of chasing their tails around faster and faster. It's not peace. Peace comes from grace, is poor. Living in the awareness of the mercy of God. Living in the awareness that you've been given what you don't deserve. What you do deserve, you've not been given. He's been given that. And what he deserves, you've been given. You don't deserve it. Was there grammar in that sentence? I'm not sure there was really, but you get the point. Grace, he says to you, let that work right through you. Classic case, years and years and years ago, with a dear lady who she'd been religious, religious in the technical sense, she'd been a nun. And one of the guys in the church we were sort of working in Platinum then was an ex-punk, and he went along visiting around the doors and this one, he knocked her door. And it was brilliant. They really got on. Fantastic. And she wasn't a Christian, but she'd been a nun. And she was out in the convent, you know, and this guy was able to... What he did is he left her a John's Gospel and told her to read it. So he's a nun, right? And he left her a John's Gospel and said, do you want to read that? It's a really good book, you know. So she did. And he went back the next week. She was saved. No, not immediately. It grew. Phenomenal. But now she's got Jesus and she's had religion for a long time. And it made very evident what is true for everybody. Grow in the grace that's in Christ Jesus, because that grace, that fundamental thing that's true, has got to work through all our thinking and questioning and responding to people and how we think of ourselves and other people. It's got to work right through you. You know, getting it like the writing in the stick of rock. You know, it says Barry Island. You know, goes all the way through. Getting the grace to work through. Paul saying, "Oh, grace to you guys. We understand that. Yeah, I know you understand it. Do you? How's it going?" Is that coming to characterise all your responses and the way you deal and handle people? Because that's where churches grow, when people see that, isn't it? When they see that. And when they see the peace that follows from that, just got to trust the mercy and the goodness of God today. I've got no hope but for that, but he's a reliable God. Doesn't that bring peace? First one to put my hand up and say, I've got a lot to learn on that. Peace from God our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ, comes right along behind that grace. And Paul needs these guys at Colossae, particularly Philemon, to have a deep understanding and appreciation of the grace of God in which they stand and the peace from God it brings to them as the result of this new relationship they've entered into with God, as their sins are just forgiven, doesn't cover it. Blotted out. Why particularly? Because Philemon has now got this runaway slave who appears to have nicked money off him and gone, Onesimus, right? And he's come back. And the situation of a slave in the Roman Empire and Roman law at that time, coming back like that, is he's probably going to get killed. At least branded on the forehead with a red hot iron. That's the minimum he's going to get. He's probably going to get killed for it. There's situations where owners took their slave who'd been captured and brought back and threw them in with lampreys like piranha. Yeah? That sort of touch. It's not a nice place to live, Rome, is it? And here he comes back. Now, how are you going to decide what you're going to do with this? Paul says, the grace of God. Remember? You didn't get what you deserve. You got what you don't deserve. And somebody else took it for you. Focus on grace. Modifying our responses. Conditioning our relationships. Set this guy free the way you've been set free, says Paul. To serve the God whose grace both Onesimus and Philemon are now thankful for. Right. Conclusion. Oh! Hold on, I didn't write that out. But conclusion.
Conclusion.
What we got in the Pauline mission then is apostolic teams seeking first the kingdom of God, therefore often in trouble with the kingdoms of men, sharing and developing ministry, sharing the faith publicly but meeting as the church in homes, and utterly focused on the grace that brings peace with God. That is what they look like. Focused on the grace that brings peace with God. Working it out in a culture far from and hostile to God. In situations like this awkward one that arises with Onesimus and Philemon, where they're going to have to do something completely countercultural because of the grace of God and the implications of it. So when people see us doing things that are completely countercultural because of the grace of God, and that to our cost because of the grace of God, that things change. The question is this. How do we, I'm looking at our church, feel free to help yourselves, look at yours, but how do we measure up to that pattern? To that biblical model of ministry?